joined this institution in 1992, and I have got more than 28 years of experience in teaching and research. I have to my credit 28 PhD dissertation in education, and I'm also working as Central Public Information Officer under RTA Act 2005 in this institute. I'm also the faculty in charge academic cell, which is responsible for admission and examination of ME and PhD program. And I have got published about 38 papers in various national and international journals. This is my brief profile. Now let us come to today's talk. Friends, all of us are performing number of activities every day. And all these activities are goal directed. So it means you have a goal you wish to achieve. Now when it comes to reaching a goal or reaching an objective, two questions come to our mind. One is, what subtasks are required to reach goal? And secondly, because one goal cannot be achieved with one task only, we have to employ a number of subtasks to reach a goal. And the second question is, in what sequence these subtasks can be performed so that we can achieve the goal effectively and efficiently? So the answer to this question lies in the analysis of a task. So today in this session, we will learn task analysis, which is a process of breaking down the complexity of an activity into easier steps, and these steps are then organized in a sequence, and students are taught those steps one by one in the sequence. Because task analysis can be carried out for a theoretical topic, it can be also carried out for a job, say setting up a lathe or fitting a film in a camera, or it can also be carried out for small acts. So task analysis. So in this session, we will learn the concept of task analysis, the principles of task analysis, what are the various kinds of task analysis, and what are the sources for carrying out task analysis, and the maxims of task analysis. And after having understood the concept, the kind, the process of task analysis, we will learn converting this task analysis into instructional objectives. Because instructional objectives also help a teacher in the selection of the method of teaching, in the selection of media, in the selection of evaluation tool. Likewise, these are also of equal importance to students, to curriculum planners, to administrator, even to parents. And in the later part, we will study the concept of instructional objective, the methods of writing instructional objectives, and the kinds of instructional objectives, or you can say the domains of instructional objective. Now let us first of all come to the concept of task analysis. Yes, task analysis is a process of breaking down or analyzing a task into smaller and more detailed constituent units, and of then sequencing these units of analysis in order of priority based upon their importance in learning. You see, it is a process of breaking down some activity into its easier steps, and those steps are then sequenced, and the students are given those steps one by one in the sequence. So it involves two subtasks. One is the analysis part, that is breaking down something into its constituent parts and then combining them, giving them some kinds of relationship, that is the synthesis part. Let me give you one illustration. Say, a task could be any job, fitting a film in a camera or setting up a lathe. Task could be any topic, say Ohm's law or solving simultaneous equation, and it could be any act. Act is the further extension of job. It has no structure. It is a small act. Okay. So how the task analysis can be carried out? Let me give you illustration. Say topic, any topic, it has at the first level topic is broken down into say 5 units of analysis, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That is for teaching a particular topic, the teacher has to explain this one, 5. Now again, these levels are further broken down into sub tasks. That is, for teaching this particular unit of analysis, teacher has to explain this one. Likewise, for teaching this fourth unit, he has to explain these 5 subunits. Now again, it can be further broken down into its smaller activities. Say, for teaching this particular unit, the teacher has to explain this one. Likewise, it can be further broken down into various sub activities. And you see at the bottom, the content is too much detailed, and at the top, it was very less detailed. So it can be carried out till the content becomes self-explanatory. That is, nothing is needed for teaching that particular component. So you see, there are several levels of analysis, and each succeeding level produces greater detail than the one before it. You see, that is, level 2 is producing greater detail than the level 1. Level 3 is producing greater detail than the one that is the level 2. Likewise, let me give you one example. Let us take the case of human body. For teaching this particular topic, the teacher has to explain the concept of head, concept of trunk, concept of limbs, concept of skin. This is the level 1. Then it is again broken down into further elements. For teaching the concept of head, the teacher has to explain the concept of face, concept of neck, concept of back. For teaching the concept of trunk, the teacher has to explain the concept of chest, stomach, back, shoulder, sides. For teaching the concept of limbs, he has to explain the concept of legs and arms. And for teaching the concept of skin, he has to explain the component of color, composition and texture. So the content has been analyzed to the second level. Now it is further being analyzed to the third level. For teaching the concept of face, the teacher has to explain the concept of ear, concept of nose, concept of hair, cheeks, chin, mouth, eyes. Likewise, for the concept of arm, upper arm, forearm, wrist, hand, elbow. And then it is further broken down into its other levels, concept of thumb, finger, palm, back, nail. So this particular illustration shows task analysis principles of levels of analysis and increasing detail, and the succeeding level follows logically and progressively from the one before it. Now I'll show you a piece of architecture. Now here the items are not, or the components are not related. Can you identify this piece of architecture? It's very difficult. Now if we put all these things, all those, these components together, then we can recognize a piece of architecture. Just see, this is a recognizable piece of architecture. So it means task analysis helps one to organize his or her thinking, and that the unrelated you can say parts or unrelated parts of something or anything are just useless or just meaningless. So now the question is, how and when it can be carried out? The answer could be anywhere where it is you can say applicable, you can make use of this task analysis. So you see how many levels. How long is a piece of string? The answer is, analyze until your task or job operations are covered completely. So you go on dividing or breaking down something into its constituent part till the job or the action is covered completely. Now let me give you the task analysis principles. Task analysis, as you have seen, is accomplished by making succeeding levels of analysis. You have seen the topic is first of all broken down to first level of analysis, then the items in the first level of analysis are further broken down into the items in the second level of analysis. So it is accomplished by making succeeding levels of analysis, and each succeeding level gives more detail than the one before it, and the each succeeding level follows logically and progressively. So each level of analysis produces its own units of analysis, and each succeeding level of analysis is more detailed than the one before it from which it is derived, and each level of analysis and associated units of analysis follow logically and progressively from those which precede them. Now, when considering a task analysis, the teacher can ask initially, what duties does doing this job entail? That is, what are the components? For example, say you have to prepare 5 cups of tea. It means you have to first of all calculate the amount of you can say raw material required, the kind of utensils required, or the kind of process you need. So, what duties does doing this job entail? What tasks are performed in each duty? Then you have to list down various subtasks for performing those duties. Then what are the elements of each task? What are the acts which go to make up each element? We'll give you one illustration. Before that, let us learn various types of task analysis. Task could be, as I said in the beginning, task could be any job, it could be any topic, it could be any skill. So accordingly, task analysis is of three types. One is the topic analysis, say Ohm's law. Topic could be say the solving simultaneous equation. So it is a detailed analysis of the intellectual part. So these are taken from the theory part. So topic analysis is carried out. Second one is the job analysis. This is a detailed analysis of tasks involving physical and psychomotor skills. Psychomotor. Psycho means mind, motor means muscle. So job involves hand and head coordination. So working, or you can setting up a lathe or fitting a film in a camera or doing some experimentation in the laboratory, all these come under the job analysis. And here we concentrate on what is done when task is carried out. Okay. And the third type of task analysis is the skill analysis, which is the further extension of job analysis. But here the teacher concentrates on, or the student concentrates on, how the job is accomplished. And this involves a very complex and intricate and subtle hand and eye coordination. Now, task analysis, let me give you a few illustrations. Before that, let us have a look at the sources of information. That is, what are the sources of information a teacher must tap before doing the task analysis? The source of information is the master. Who is the master? A person who can perform the job at the required level of proficiency. Now, you have to select the master very carefully, because if master's level of proficiency is too high, it means there is a danger of overtraining to the students. And if the proficiency level of the master is too low, it results into a danger of, you can say, undertraining. So you have to select the master very cautiously. For example, the master who is performing a skill like say joining two joints, okay, welding two joints. So you have to see what are the activities he is performing for welding two joints. So another is the student. Student could be the pass out student, or he could be the student who is presently learning that particular concept or the skill. Teachers who are teaching this particular subject, the course material, the syllabus requirement or the curriculum requirement, the course examination, question paper, and the requirement of the client. So all these persons need to be, all these persons or the material need to be tapped while doing task analysis. And you can employ various methods or procedures for collecting the information. the procedure or the various techniques could be the observation. Say the welder is welding two joints. So what type of activities he is performing, you can have an observation, or you can record its video recording. You can interview him. You can prepare a questionnaire. You can prepare work diaries. You can prepare job checklist and activity list. So these can be used for carrying out task analysis. Now let me give you a very interesting illustration. Job of an engine mechanic. Now the mechanic's jobs are divided into say five duties: tuning the carburetor, adjusting tappets, adjusting spark plug gap, changing engine oil, or cleaning the spark plug gap. Now let us take one of these duties, changing engine oil. Now what are the tasks? Task would be, he has to jack up the car first. Now you see, these tasks are broken down and these are arranged or organized in a particular sequence. So for changing engine oil, the mechanic has to first jack up the car. He has to place the oil container under the sump or remove the sump plug and allowing then oil to drain away. Now let us further analyze one of these tasks, and now these are called as task analysis. Say jacking up the car. Now what are the task elements? Firstly, the mechanic has to acquire right kind of jack, because there are so many jacks available. So he has to select a suitable jack suiting to a particular vehicle. Then he has to position the jack where it has to be kept, and then to what height he has to manipulate the jack. So you see, these are the tasks and elements for performing the activity of jacking up the car. Likewise, all these tasks can be further broken down into their sub task elements till those tasks are or those jobs are performed completely. So this is an example for mechanical engineering. Let us take another example: solving networks by Kirchhoff's law. Now first law he has to explain, second law and solving networks. Now first law is broken down into the concept of network of conductors, concept of current, concept of algebraic sum, and then after having understood these concepts, the statement of law is taught to the students. Likewise, for second law, concept of current, concept of resistance, concept of algebraic sum, concept of EMF. Concept of network of conductors. So the teacher will explain that conductors are the substances which offer little resistance, and the concept of network. So for teaching the concept of network or conductor, teacher has to explain first of all about the conductor and the network. Then combining these two will be the concept of network of conductor. Likewise, for concept of current, that is flow of electrons, and the unit is coulomb per second. Likewise, first law, these are the two parts, like this. So this is how. Now you see, this is a kind of concept map. Now if you have with you in the classroom, I think you need not carry bigger notes in the classroom. You can develop your lecture with the help of this one page only. Let me take another example. Topic is say black and white film processing. Very interesting topic. And for this black and white film processing, the person has to perform three activities. One is this, second one is maintaining safety in the dark room, third one is something different. Now let us take this maintaining safety in the dark room. For this, teacher has to explain these five sub parts, and one of them is accounting for personal safety. Now for this, the teacher will explain these eight task elements. One is describe risk exaggerated because of the darkness. This could be one. Explain the importance of orientation within the dark room. Name the chemicals in use. Describe the individual danger of each chemical. State the dangers arising from spillages. Point out need for consideration for the safety of others. Demonstrate importance of awareness in the dark, and explain clearly the emergency procedures for dark room. Now these 8 sub, you can say task elements are required for explaining accounting for personal safety, right? So you will start from the bottom, that is you will teach from the bottom, and then you will make up the connections, and then you will reach to the objective. Another example, collection of soil sample by auger boring. First of all, selecting equipment, this is one step. Second is locate and clean site, make a bore hole, collect sample. Now this is broken down into at the level 1. Now at the level 2, selecting equipment will is broken down into identifying the right equipment, choose suitable auger, clean and locate site. For this, identify the site, locate site, clean site. For cleaning site, the person has to remove grass from test site, he has to land the surface using appropriate tool. Now for making a bore hole, he will operate the auger. For operating the auger, he has to assemble the auger. For assembling the auger, he has to first fix the drill rod, he has to then fix T-junction and insert the handle, you might have noticed. Then clean the auger, because it must be, it might be, you can say, purana hai ya usme koi gandagi lagi hui hai. Then you have to position the auger on the test surface, insert auger into the soil, and then rotate the auger and push the auger to the bottom. So you will get some soil. Now collecting sample. Now remove auger from the hole, then remove soil from the auger, collect soil in a polythene bag, and then seal the envelope. So this is how the complete analysis is carried out. So it's a wonderful, you can say, tool in the hands of the teacher. Let us take one more, DC motor. The teacher has to explain the principle of DC motor, the construction of DC motor, and the working principle of, you can say, working motor. For explaining or for making them understood about the principle, he has to explain the concept of magnetic field, concept of alignment of magnetic field, concept of torque angle, concept of brush and commutator arrangement. For magnetic field, the teacher will explain the concept of polarity, electromagnets, and the strength. And the, for alignment of magnetic field, non-alignment products, non-alignment produces torque, constant non-alignment produces rotation. Likewise, torque angle, angle of non-alignment of two fields, torque depends on magnitude of the torque angle. Let us take one more example. Job is right wiring a plug. Duties are color code, preparing leads, attaching leads, safety checks for wiring a plug. Now you must have seen that here I am using the decimal classification. 1.1 means the first activity of the task, color code. So new code, just see, new code, old code, twin flux. For preparing lead, the tasks are removing cover, remove the outer insulation, identify terminals, cut the leads, strip the leads. Attaching leads require task, twist standards, route the leads, wrap the leads around the terminal, tighten the terminal nuts, and secure gripper bar. For safety check, the concept of polarity, security of leads and flux, correct value fuse, and the replacing the cover. Another example from mathematics. Topic is solving mathematical problems by using log tables. These are the four applications of log tables: multiplying two numbers, dividing one number by another non-zero number, subtracting one number from the other, and finding a to power b. Now let us take one out of these four applications. For multiplying two numbers, let us see what are the subtasks. These are the subtasks: finding the characteristics and mantissa of two numbers, adding the logarithm together, then anti log the sum, fixing the decimal point and connecting answer to appropriate number of significant figures. Now let us see, 1.1 is further broken down into 1.1.1, 1.1.2, 1.1.3. That is, for finding the characteristics of two numbers, locate first two significant figures of each number in left hand column of the log table, locate third figure of each number in appropriate middle column headed 0 to 9, and locate fourth figure in add column headed 0 to 9 on the right hand side of the page. This is how the task analysis is carried out. So I have given you a number of examples. So I hope you will appreciate the concept of task analysis, and it's a very useful tool in the hands of the teacher, because after doing task analysis you can formulate the instructional objectives. Now what are the rules for rules of sequencing or arranging the task elements? Let us see. One is, proceed from known to unknown. It is always better to begin with what students already know and then proceed slowly what they do not know, because known things are easily accepted by the students. So known, then proceed from simple to difficult. Again, simple task is easily understood by the student as compared to the complex task. Then while doing task analysis, you have to keep in mind the principle of moving from concrete to abstract. What is concrete? Concrete is something which is composed of many masses, and abstract is something which is reduced to summary. Say the concept of mouse, concept of paper. So these are concrete concepts because these are the tangible objects you can see, you can feel. So concrete concepts. Then abstract concepts. What are the abstract concepts? Like concept of inertia, concept of force, concept of honesty. These are abstract concepts because these need to be defined. For example, concept of force. This is an abstract concept. Why? Because if you look its meaning in the dictionary, you will not find one meaning of the word force, because a force as a verb has got some different meaning. Force as a noun, force as a adverb, all these are different meanings. So you need to explain in a particular context. So proceed from concrete to abstract. And another very important principle is, proceed from observation to reasoning. You show a number of illustrations to the students, let them observe and let them make a generalization. So these are the four basic principles or rules which can be used for sequencing the task elements in a particular task. So this part is about task analysis. Now let me come to the concept of instructional objectives. So first of all, what do we mean by an objective? Objective is a sentence or a statement which describes what the individual will be able to do at the end of a particular activity. And when it comes to instructional objective, it means a statement or sentence which describes what the student will be able to do at the end of a unit of instruction. Let me take one topic. Topic is, say, Ohm's law. Now the objective is, the broad objective is that after teaching this topic, students will be able to understand Ohm's law. Now what are the specific, as you can say, objectives? The student will be able to define current, he will be able to define voltage, he will be able to name the device which measure current, he will be able to name the device which measure voltage or which measure resistance. He will be able to draw the circuit diagram for verification of Ohm's law. He will be able to take certain readings. He will be able to verify Ohm's law. He will be able to state Ohm's law. He will be able to draw a graph between V and I, and he will be able to list situations where Ohm's law can be applicable. So I have used a number of specific objectives like define, state, draw, list. So these lead to the attainment of general objective that they will be able to understand Ohm's law after the topic is over. Now, why there is a need for instructional objective for a teacher? You see, education to be purposeful must be goal directed, because learning is always goal directed. We learn many things in order to achieve number of objectives. So process of teaching, the process of providing learning experiences to the students, providing opportunity for interaction must be directed towards these goals. As you might have seen in the case of task analysis, I asked two questions. One is, in order to reach goal, first question that comes to my mind is, what subtasks are required to reach goal? Second is, in what sequence these subtasks can be performed to achieve the objective effectively? Okay, so here, this is the importance of writing instructional objectives, because these provide basis for the selection of method of teaching, for the selection of instructional media, for the selection of evaluation tool, and because these will help us understand to what extent the students have achieved the learning outcomes. In any system, there is a great concern for effectiveness. Now, what is effectiveness? Product is evaluated with respect to laid down specification. If the product which we have obtained is compared against the laid down specification, and then the product meets the laid down criteria, then we say the system is effective. Okay. For example, when I say the objective is, after the topic is over, students will be able to define force, and I am asking him or her to answer a question, what is force? Now, what is force is measuring something different. Our objective was that he is able to define force, because when I ask what is force, the student may give answer, they may give different answer to this particular question. But if I ask define force, everybody will give almost the same answer. So what is force is not effective, you can say, question for measuring the objective of defining force. So product is evaluated with respect to laid down specification, and one cannot visualize a productive system where operations are carried out without specifying the end product. And who is the end product in our system? Product is the learning outcome of the student, learning outcome, and learning outcomes of the students are specified in the form of instructional objectives. Now, what are the benefits of instructional objective to the teacher? Firstly, instructional objectives communicate to the teacher about the intent of instruction, that is, where he is to reach, how he will reach there, and how he will come to know when he has reached or when he has arrived. So instructional objectives provide basis for the selection of content, teaching activities, methods and media for instruction, provide basis for the evaluation of student learning by describing performance to be measured, determining students' present level of mastery for a specified objective at any time, and identifying students who have acquired prior to instruction the level of excellence required for successful performance on a given objective. It provides basis for determining the adequacy of the instruction or adequacy of the method of teaching, adequacy of the method of evaluation. It also helps the curriculum planners to arrange sequence of courses when given clearly specified objectives. Now, what is instruction objective? As I told you in the beginning, It is a sentence or a statement which describes what the student will be able to do at the end of a unit of instruction. They are the end results of learning stated in terms of changes in the learning behavior. Instructional objectives are the intended learning outcomes at the end of the instruction. Focus is on the product of learning, not on the process of learning. So it is the student centered. It is not teacher centered. In the past, we used to have teacher centered objective. If in the past you ask some teacher, he would say, my objective is to enable them understand, to enable them know. Now the shift is from teacher centered to student centered. That is what he will be able to do at the end of a unit of instruction, not the teacher's objective. It is now the student objective. Teacher centered. Teach the students how computers evolved into microprocessors. Now, student center kya hai? Explain. They will be able to explain the evolution of computers into microprocessor. Teacher center objective kya hai? My purpose is to teach them how computers evolved into microprocessor. Ye teacher objective tha. Ab ye teacher center se student center mein ho gaya. Wo kya ho gaya? What the student will be able to do, what he will be able to do, he will be able to explain the evolution of computers into microprocessor. So now we are measuring student performance. Behavioral objective. When objectives are written with a verb which specifies an observable behavior as well as that behavior can be measured also, so such objectives are called behavioral objective. Are written with a verb, he will be able to define force, he will be able to name one sulfide ore of copper, okay, name, define, explain, describe, state, list. So these are action verb, these can be observed, these can be measured. Observable kaise hain? Ab jaise dekhiye maine bola, what do you know about force? अथा सागर, अब इसको ऑब्जर्व नहीं किया जा सकता क्योंकि इसमें डिफरेंट स्टूडेंट्स दे विल इंटरप्रेट दिस क्वेश्चन डिफरेंटली. लेकिन जब क्वेश्चन आता है डिफाइन फोर्स, सो एवरीबॉडी विल फिक्स द स्कोप बिकॉज द पर्टिकुलर डायरेक्शन इज गिवन टू देम. वेयर एज इन केस ऑफ व्हाट डू यू नो अबाउट फोर्स, फिक्सिंग ऑफ द स्कोप इज वेरी डिफिकल्ट. हर एक स्टूडेंट जो है वो अपनी उस समय जो मेंटल स्थिति है उसको देखते हुए उसका स्कोप फिक्स करता है, राइट? अब मैं सवाल पूछता हूं, एक्सप्लेन द वर्किंग प्रिंसिपल ऑफ कार्बोरेटर ऑफ एन आईसी इंजन. तो दिस इज ए बिहेवियरल ऑब्जेक्टिव विच कैन बी मेजर्ड. अब यहां पर डिफरेंट स्टूडेंट्स ने इस क्वेश्चन का आंसर दिया. एक स्टूडेंट को 10 में से 8 मिले, दूसरे को 10 में से 5 मिले. अब जिसको 5 मिले वो टीचर के पास जाता है कि साहब आपने मेरे को ये 5 क्यों दिए, मैंने भी पूरा लिखा है, मैंने सिर्फ डायग्राम नहीं बनाई. तो टीचर कहता है हाँ आपने डायग्राम नहीं बनाई इसलिए आपको पूरे नंबर नहीं मिले. तो स्टूडेंट कहता है सर इसमें क्वेश्चन में कहीं भी इंडिकेटेड नहीं था कि आपको स्केच बनाना है. तो क्यों ना हम क्वेश्चन की स्टेटमेंट में ही उसका स्कोप फिक्स करें. दैट इज एक्सप्लेन विद अ नीट स्केच the working principle of carburetor of an IC engine. Ab main question puchta hu, what are Newton's laws of motion? Again, this question will be interpreted differently by different students. Now, if I ask, explain or describe each of three Newton's laws of motion with examples. Again, this is there is some direction, but the scope is not fixed because one student will give one example for each of the three laws, another student will give two examples each for the three laws, another student gives three examples each for each of the three laws. Now there is no limitation. So what we can ask is describe each of three Newton's laws of motion with one example. So this is how the objective can be made observable as well as measurable. Examples are, define the term baud rate, explain the use of logic analyzer to test a microprocessor based system, describe the function of each pin of 8085A microprocessor, describe the three component parts of SQL, explain data definition commands. So these are some examples of the instruction objectives. Now, methods of writing instruction objectives, there are basically two methods. One is the Meagher's approach, and second is the Gronlund approach, which is very much useful in technical education. First one is the Meagher's approach. Here, the purpose is to list the specific behavior students are to exhibit at the end of the instruction, define, explain, describe, and so on. And you can have as many statements as are needed to describe all the needed outcome. Now, instruction objective, according to Meagher's approach, should contain the terminal behavior, action verb, write, label, solve, identify, differentiate, etc. Second is condition under which behavior is to be performed, that is restriction and limitation. And third is the criteria of acceptable performance, that is the level of performance to evaluate success of the performance. Example is given a circuit diagram for Philips P231 amplifier and P231 amplifier with one defect, the student will locate the fault in 10 minutes. Now, there are three conditions. First was terminal behavior. Terminal behavior is mein kya hai? That he will be able to locate the fault. Ab second kya tha? Condition under which behavior is to be performed. Wo kya hai? Given a circuit diagram for Philips P231 with one defect. And third kya hai? Criteria of acceptable performance, that is you will be able to locate the fault in 10 minutes. So this approach is suitable for only simple tasks. This is a simple task. Now this, let us have a look at the second approach, which is given by Gronlund. It is suitable for higher level of instruction. In this particular approach, general objectives are followed by a list of or set of specific objectives. General objective refers to summaries of learning outcomes which express generalized behavior expected of students at a satisfactory level of generality. For this, I can use verb like know, understand, appreciate. For example, after the topic is over, students will be able to understand Ohm's law. Understand is very vague, or you can say very global, because it may include many things, like as I said in the beginning, that the definition of current, voltage, resistance, the devices which measure these particular you can say components, then circuit diagram, taking readings, then making a relationship between the three concepts, that is stating the Ohm's law, then drawing the graph between V and I, and then listing the situation where this can be used. So general objective. Then the second one is this example, understand the evolution of 4-bit microprocessor into 8-bit microprocessor, understand the operation of memory devices, develop relational database for a specific organization, apply SQL commands in a given situation. So these are very, very you can say general. Guidelines for writing general objective: begin each objective with a verb know, understand, appreciate, apply, analyze, formulate, judge, etc. State objectives in terms of student performance. They will be able to understand. State objectives so that it includes only one general learning outcome for one topic. State objectives at the proper level of generality. Okay, because under the cognitive domain, there are various levels, and we have to see at what level we will be able to deal with in a particular class suiting to different students. Specific objectives. These are the precise statements of learning outcomes and express the specific behavior which is to be overtly observed. So each specific objective begins with a verb that indicates observable behavior. For example, write, identify, define, distinguish, compare, demonstrate, compute. Examples are define the term indirect cost and not what is indirect cost. Explain the second law of thermodynamics. Buffer the basic buses of the 8088 microprocessor. Describe the working principle of cooling system of an IC engine. So describe, explain, buffer, name, state, describe or explain. These are the specific objectives. Let us take one example where you will notice the general objective as well as the specific objectives. General objective is, after the topic is over, students will be able to understand microprocessor architecture. Very global. Now, in order to reach this goal, there are some sets of, you can say, specific objectives which are based upon task analysis, because you have already carried out task analysis. So identify, first of all, he will be able to identify the components of a computer system. He will be able to explain the purpose of the buses in a computer system. He will be able to draw the circuit diagram to buffer both a unidirectional and a bidirectional bus. He will be able to describe the methods employed to address data in a microprocessor. He will be able to distinguish between the STD and the S100 buses. Guidelines for writing specific objective. Begin each specific objective with a verb that specifies definite observable behavior. Define, explain, describe, name, enumerate, elucidate, illustrate. These are the specific, or apply, state, write. List a sufficient number of specific objectives under each general objective to describe adequately the behavior of the students who have achieved the objective. Now, पहले वाले example में आपने देखा था, एक general objective था और उसके हमने पांच specific objective बनाए. तो ये कोई fix नहीं है. हमने specific objective उतने बनाने हैं जिससे वो general objective जो है वो achieve हो जाए. Now let us take another example. ये है topic. Understand. Topic is, after the topic is over, students will be able to understand basic input-output interface circuitry. And corresponding to this general objective, the specific objectives are, which are five in number in this case, describe the operation of simple input and output devices, describe the interface between the microprocessor and the outside world, select an input-output device by decoding the memory map, describe the operation of 8155 peripheral interface adapters, and develop the software required to initialize and program the 8155. Another topic, critical path method. The general objective is, after the topic is over, students will be able to apply the CPM, critical path method, for planning and scheduling a project. Again, a global. Now, for this, what are the small, you can say, enabling objectives, which are smaller in scope? Break down the project into discrete activities. Assign time duration to individual activities. Explain the rules for developing CPM networks. Explain the term critical path. Generate CPM network for the project. Analyze the network and identify the critical path. So these five subtasks are required to reach the general objective of applying the CPM for planning and scheduling a project. let me give you the broad schematic layout of taxonomies proposed by Bloom and others. The broad objective of any technical education system is to develop all-round personality of the students. Developing students in an all-round way means developing their capabilities in intellect and non-intellect areas. And these areas are concerned with knowledge, skills, and attitude. Now, what is knowledge? Knowledge means what does someone need to know in order to do a job? That is the theory part. And what is skill? What does someone need to be able to do? So, skill is something which involves hand and head coordination, that is working in a laboratory, performing some experiment, setting up a lathe, psychomotor. And the attitude is what sort of approach does a person doing that job need to have? So, KSA are required for developing all-round personality in the students. So, keeping this all-round personality of the students in mind, the Bloom has classified the learning outcomes into three domains, and he has named these three domains as cognitive domain, affective domain, psychomotor. Cognitive domain is concerned with knowledge. Affective domain is concerned with our affect, our feelings, our attitude, our interest, and psychomotor domain is concerned with the skill. Okay, so cognitive domain refers to intellectual outcomes. Here we include knowledge, understanding, problem solving. Affective domain is concerned with our feelings, attitudes. So it refers to attitudes, interest, values, feelings, emotions. And psychomotor domain refers to motor skill development, which may include hand and head coordination. So handwriting, drawing, typewriting, operating, all these come under the psychomotor domain. And there are various levels which are given under these three domains. In the cognitive domain, there are six levels, beginning with remembering, understanding, applying, analyzing, evaluating, and creating. Under the affective domain, there are five levels: receiving, responding, valuing, organization, characterization. And under psychomotor domain, there are five levels: imitation, manipulation, precision, articulation, and naturalization. And in this particular session, we will learn in detail the cognitive domain. Now, Bloom, in the initial taxonomy, under the cognitive domain, the levels are knowledge, comprehension, application, analysis, synthesis, and evaluation. But he has revised his taxonomy, and now, because knowledge involves process of thinking, and since this lowest level knowledge involves the remembering of the previously learned facts, so this cannot be treated as the process of thinking. So that is why he has renamed it as remembering. Again, because here he has used the nouns knowledge, comprehension, application, analysis, synthesis. Now he has translated these nouns into verb, because verbs describe the action. So remembering, understanding, applying, analyzing, evaluating and creating. अब उसने evaluation को पहले ले लिया, क्योंकि evaluation analysis के बाद evaluation जरूरी है. Evaluation करने के बाद ही you can create something. Okay. Now let us have look at these levels. Remembering means recalling information, recognizing, listing, describing, retrieving, naming, finding. Understanding includes explaining ideas or concept, interpreting, summarizing, paraphrasing, classifying, explaining. Applying means using information in another familiar situation, implementing, carrying out, using, executing. Analyzing means breaking down something into parts to explore the understanding and various relationship. So comparing, organizing, deconstructing, that is dismantling, you can say, interrogating, finding, evaluating means justifying a decision or course of action. And here the verbs used are check, hypothesizing, critiquing, experimenting, judging. Creating involves generating new ideas, products or ways of viewing things. So designing, constructing, planning, producing, intervening. Now let us have look at these levels. Remembering, that is recall or recognition of specific information. Remembering refers to recalling information. Water boils at 100 degrees centigrade. Name one sulfide ore of copper. State SI unit of force. These require no understanding. He is simply recognizing. He is simply reproducing. So the action verbs which can be used for writing specific objectives at this level include choose, cite, enumerate, label, list, locate, match, name, outline, quote, read, recall, record, and so on. At the next level is the understanding, that is explaining the idea or the concept, that is he is able to grasp the meaning of the material by interpreting and translating. When I say normal temperature of human body is 98.6 degree Fahrenheit, convert it into degree Celsius. So he will be able to convert from one form to another form only once he has understood the relationship. That is the relationship between degree Fahrenheit and degree Celsius. When I say the India's population by 2010 is this, 2000 was this, 2010 was this, give the projection for 2020. So he will be able to give projection. So these are the verbs which can be used under this level: classify, convert, define, describe, estimate, explain, express, identify, indicate, interpret, outline, recognize, report, research, restate, review, translate. Higher level is applying, that is using information in another familiar situation. Now applying doesn't mean that student has to put the values in a formula and find the answer. For example, F is equal to MA. The value of F and M are given and the student has to find out the value of A. This is not application. Application means how this relationship, that is F is equal to MA, can be used to solve another problem. Okay, so solving classroom learning, that is using classroom learning to solve day-to-day problems. So the objectives include, or the verbs include, adapt, apply, calculate, change, compute, construct, demonstrate, draw, exhibit, show, generalize, interpret, illustrate, manipulate, and so on. Next level is analyzing, which involves critical thinking. That is breaking down information into parts to explore understandings and relationship. That is, he is able to say identify factors of air pollution. This could be one objective, or explain reasons of transmission losses, or identify mistakes committed in the writing of a program. Analysis. So these are some of the action verbs which can be used for writing objectives at this level: analyze, appraise, arrange, compare, contrast, criticize, detect, and so on. Abhi main aapse poochta hoon, can you analyze this LCD projector? What do I mean? I mean, you look into various components of the LCD projector. What are their functions? And when you are looking into the various components of the LCD projector, you are also looking into various relationships, how one component is connected to another component. Because if you do not understand the relationship, interrelationship then you will not be able to reassemble it. Okay, so at the time of analysis, you have to look into constituent parts and you have to also study the various relationships. Then under the cognitive domain comes evaluating, which refers to again critical thinking, but at this stage the student is able to justify a decision or a course of action. So appraise, assess, choose, compare, conclude, decide, differentiate, justifying, discriminating, evaluate, infer, judge, predict. So these are action verbs which can be used for writing instructional objectives at the level of evaluating. Then next is the creating. Creating again refers to critical thinking, but at this stage the student is able to generate new idea, new products or new ways of viewing things. So the action verbs which can be used for writing objectives at this level include act, assemble, blend, combine, compile, compose, develop, design, hypothesize, invent, predict, and so on. So these are some of the action verbs which can be used for writing objectives at this level. So let me give you one illustration. So it's a sample unit, travel. Okay, remembering. Now remembering will include recall of previously learned material, information. How many ways can you travel from one place to another? Try to remember. List and draw all the ways you know. Describe one of the vehicles from your list. Draw a diagram and label the parts. Collect transport pictures from magazines and make a poster with information. So this is at the lowest level as you. Remembering. Understanding. How do you get from your institution or from your institution to your home? Explain the method of travel and draw a map. Write a play about a form of modern transport. Explain how you felt the first time you rode a bicycle. Make your desk into a form of transport. So understanding. Then applying. Explain why some vehicles are large and others small. Write a story about the uses of both. Read a story about the little red engine and make up a play about it. Survey 10 other children to see what bikes they ride. Display on a chart or a graph at the application stage. Analyzing. Make a jigsaw puzzle of children using bikes safely. What problems are there with modern forms of transport and their users? Write a report. Use a Venn diagram to compare boats to planes or helicopters to bicycles. So, analyzing. Evaluating. What changes would you recommend to road rules to prevent traffic accidents? Debate whether we should be able to buy fuel at a cheaper rate. Rate transport from slow to the fast, etc. Then at the creating stage, invent a vehicle. Draw or construct it after careful planning. What sort of transport will there be in the 20 years time? Discuss, write about it and report to the class. Write a song about traveling in different forms of transport. You see how the teacher can prepare his or her lecture plan by considering these six levels under cognitive domain. So with this we come to the end of our session. So friends, today in this session we have learned the concept of task analysis, the process of task analysis, and the task analysis helps the teacher formulate instructional objectives, and instructional objectives help the teacher in the selection of content matter, in the selection of method of teaching, in the selection of media, in the selection of intervention tool, and we have also learned the two methods of writing the instructional objective. One was the Meagher's approach, and the second was the granular approach, which includes general objective and specific objective, and which is used in technical education system, this granular approach. And then we have learned the Bloom's taxonomy of classification of various domains, and we have also learned in detail the cognitive domain, which includes six levels, beginning with the remembering, then moving to understanding, applying, analyzing, evaluating, and creating. Thank you very much, and if you have any query or if you have any question, you are welcome. Yes.
Thank you, Dr. Zad. Myself, Dr. Sharma from MMU Molana. Very nice illustration of various elements one has to introduce to improve the teaching curriculum. My general concern was I would like to have your recommendation, like in today's scenario. We see like every teacher is loaded with too much teaching load, more than 18 hours per week. And suppose one has to take like 3 units in a day, and how much one should compromise, or how he should manage time to introduce all these elements into his teaching curriculum, and without compromising on any of the teaching standards. So that's what I wanted to have your little recommendation. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I won't say that teachers are overloaded. Teachers get sufficient time in day-to-day working. You see, preparing a task analysis does not require too much time. He has to simply prepare one sheet, this task analysis, and he has to write only the objectives. So if, because there are 40 or 45 lectures in a semester, and he has to prepare only these, because this will help him, because this will give him direction. This will provide motivation to the students, because when if they know what they will be able to do at the end of a unit of instruction, that will provide them motivation, because this requires no labor, no not much time is required. I think they can do it. Any other question from other centers?
Sir, we thank you for such an enlightening lecture, and especially for teaching us at least 100 extra books which we can use in planning our lectures and in drafting our test papers. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.